Let's please take our seat. You are most welcome to the service this morning. We believe in God, the covenant-keeping God, that which He has determined to do will be made known in our lives. In the mighty name of Jesus. From Monday evening, we've started talking about the covenant-keeping God. And we have looked at the subject from different angles. Time may not permit us to go back into them this morning. But I want to say, all the recordings for the program,
the love of my life,
the program, process of the program are recorded. You can see them at the technical room to get a copy of all the details. We'll be looking at Exodus chapter 23 from verse 25 to 28. Exodus chapter 23, reading from verse 25 to 28. And ye shall serve the Lord your God, and he shall bless thy bread and thy waters, and I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. There shall nothing cast their young, nor barren in thy land. The number of thy days I will fulfill. I will send my fear before thee, and I will destroy all the people to whom thou shalt come. And I will make all thy enemy turn their back unto thee. And I will send honest before thee, which shall drive out the Hivites and the Canaanites, the Hittites from before thee. From that passage, God demanded one thing from us, and he promised about five things to us. He said, you will serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your water. And we call that the covenant of prosperity. Each time you serve God, there is in one way that it shows and it's evident, and it is in the blessing that comes upon your life. There is something that shows when you serve the Lord. Malachi chapter 3:18 says, God will always put a difference between those who serve him and those who do not serve him. I am believing God that at this time, the difference will be clear in your life that you serve the Lord. We went further to say, it will take sickness away from the midst of thee. We call that the covenant of healing. If God takes sickness away from you, which means the sickness in your body will be healed, and no other sickness will ever come unto your body. Now, God has placed the price of our healing upon Christ. And that's why the passage in Isaiah 53 verse 5 says, he was wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. And so it never matter what is the sickness anywhere in your life. The healing power of God will flush them out. In as much as you serve the Lord and you give your heart unto him, sickness will not find a place in your body. In the mighty name of Jesus. He said, there shall nothing cast their young. There shall be no abortive effort in your life, nor be barren in the land. You know, there will not be unfruitful effort in your life. That we call the covenant of fruitfulness. There is a design of God for each and every one of us. And this design is to make each one of us fruitful. And I want to believe God that in every aspect of life, the first blessing that God ever pronounced in Genesis chapter 1 verse 28 is to be fruitful. Everything that you lay your hands upon will produce fruit. In the mighty name of Jesus. He said, the numbers of your days, you will fulfill. That is a covenant of long life. You will not die young, but you will fulfill the numbers of your day. You will live to glorify the name of the Lord. On this basis, this morning, I am standing on this exalted altar. From wherever untimely death has ever been found, an end come to them in the mighty name of Jesus. Whatever it is that has been snatching any member of the family at their prime age, today we connect with the covenant of the Most High and we say an end come to such in the mighty name of Jesus. God has promised to satisfy his children with long life and show them his salvation. May you enjoy and experience long life in the mighty name of Jesus. And so God never stopped there. He said, I will send my fear before thee, and I will destroy all the people to whom thou shalt come, and make all your enemy to turn their back at you. That is a covenant of victory. That in every aspect of your life, God wants to make you victorious. When your enemy turns their backs at you, it only means that they are running away from you. That there won't be any reason for you to run from the enemy, but the enemy begin to run from you. When they hear your voice, they become tremble. When they hear your coming, they begin to run. In the psalmist in chapter 18, verse 44, he said, as soon as they hear me, he said, they will be afraid of me. Now, beginning from today, the Lord will create your fear, you know, to tremble all the enemy. That as soon as they hear you, they will be afraid of you. They will fade out even as they see you in the mighty name of Jesus. There will be none who will be strong enough to confront you in the mighty name of Jesus. The power of the Most High will rest upon your life in the mighty name of Jesus. He now promised to drive away the Canaanites, the Hivites, the Hittites out from before thee. And that is to give you a possession. So which means you will possess your possession. Everything he has promised will surely come to pass. In the mighty name of Jesus. The covenant keeping God. So what is a covenant? We said a covenant is like a contract. It involves two or more people. In the case here, it involves you and God. God is the covenantor, the one who initiated the covenant, and you are the covenantee. The one who is the beneficiary of the deal. A covenant, unlike a promise, is a vow that cannot be broken once the required condition is met. Once you meet the required condition, it cannot be broken. It just has to be fulfilled. And for each one of us who is a child of God, we are a child of covenant. And one thing that drives the kingdom of God is a covenant. There is no force in the kingdom of God that is as strong as the force of covenant, because what God has promised, he will never repent from. He will never change his mind. The covenantor will always keep to his part. As a matter of fact, he has so much in his hand, willing and ready to give out. All he's looking for is for each one of us to play our own role and our own part, and then we begin to get all that he has designed and ordained for our life. While men may be unstable, variables in the, you know, in the deal of the covenant, God is ever constant. He said to Abraham in Genesis chapter 17, when you read in verses 3 and 4, after Abraham has diverted the promise he made with him, and for 13 years, there was a closed heaven over Abraham. Because when you read between Genesis 16:16 and Genesis 17:1, there was a silence of 13 years. So God came back in this regard and said, as for me, my covenant is with you. As for me, that statement indicates I am constant. I am steady. I am faithful. I will never digress. I will never fail. Psalm 89 verse 34. Psalm 89 verse 34. He said, my covenant will I not break, nor alter the things that is gone out of my lips. My covenant, I will not break. As far as God is concerned, he's saying, I will never, ever break my covenant. What does that mean? As for you, I am ready to bless you. I am ready to make you fruitful. I am ready to lengthen your days. I am ready to give you victory. I am ready to give you all the godly possession. God is ever willing and ever ready to give us everything that he has promised. My prayer this morning is that everything that we must do in order to achieve it, the Lord will enable us to do in the mighty name of Jesus. He only waiting for us to take our steps. He is constant. He is steady. He's only waiting for us to align ourselves. May the grace of God align us with the blessing of God this morning. And may that blessing that can never fail come over our lives. In the mighty name of Jesus. The covenant of God is stronger than any climate. Whatever is the situation, whatever is the condition, whatever happened, the covenant of God is stronger. It is man who will look at things and say, well, at this particular time, God should understand. But as far as God is concerned, at the time when it is most critical, that is when God wants the covenant children to prove themselves. The reason why a number of people will not pay their tithe is because they will say, well, God knows that there is a recession. God knows that things are not flowing. Now, God never demands from you what he has not provided for you. All he demanded for, from what I have provided, give me my portion. And it is my portion that will make what you have left in your hand meaningful. The reason why, you know, the money in the hands of many are not meaningful is because they have eaten the portion of God with their own. When you give God his portion, the remainder in your hand become meaningful. God breathed upon what you have, and then the abundant blessing of God begin to manifest. In the time of scarcity, that is exactly when we need to prove our love and our faith in God more, so that God might also show his almightiness more over our lives. Amen. When you look at the story of the widow of Zarephath, that we read about in 1 Kings chapter 17, as you read from verse 8, it was in the midst of 7 years of drought, when things were dry in the land, when riverbed were dry, when farmers asked no harvest, she has her last meal, but she was ready to also connect, cut covenant with the little that she has. People of God, if you say God should understand, he will understand. But that will stop the covenant of God from manifesting. One thing that will keep the covenant of God flowing and that will keep your blessings flowing is the way you run, as you run and service your covenant with the Most High. When we keep the covenant, every crisis will be removed. Every debt will be removed. Nothing stops God's covenant. In Jeremiah chapter 33, as you read from verse 20 to 21, Jeremiah 33, verse 20 to 21, he said, thus says the Lord, if ye can break my covenant of the day and my covenant of the night, and there should not be day and night in their season, he said, then may also my covenant be broken with David, my servant, that he should not have a son to reign upon his throne, and with the Levites, the priests, my minister. If anything, he said, my covenant is as constant, as stable as the rising of the sun. As long as the sun rises and sets, what I have said, stand. As long as we have the rising and the setting of the same. That's why the passage in Genesis 8:22 says, as long as the earth remaineth, the covenant of God remains and it stands sure. My prayer for you this morning is that the grace to continue to operate in this covenant, God will grant unto you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. What is it that is needed to enjoy the covenant? Primarily, understanding of the covenant and how to connect it. Until you have understanding of what God is saying, definitely you don't enjoy it. For anyone to pass any examination, you need a clear understanding of the test or the question. Now, many people fail examination or test not because they know nothing, but because they don't know enough. So they got some mark, but it is not up to. So understanding is to give you an holistic approach onto the matter. To succeed in the time that we are requires a clear understanding of what God demanded. And where do we get that understanding from? From the Word of God. The more you connect yourself with the Word of God, the more of the blessing of God you will enjoy. The more of the blessing of God you will experience. The more of the blessing of God that will be satisfied. From the Word of God, we find all the promises and the demand of God. And once you can fulfill the condition, we begin to see the manifestation. Mary, the mother of Jesus, gave those servants the key in John chapter 2 in verse 5, where she said, whatever he asks you to do, do it. Whatever he asks you to do, do it. So until you have understanding of what he asks you to do, you may not be able to do it. You need to be able to see God placing certain demand, asking you to take certain steps. And when those steps are taken, something changes around your life. When you look at the story of Peter in Luke chapter 5, and you read from verse 1, now this man has gone to fish as a professional fisherman, went in the evening. Ordinarily, a fisherman who went for evening fishing won't be there till the breaking of the day. They will have returned. Those who want to buy from them will go very early as 5 a.m. to go and get the fish from them. But because he caught nothing, he was there preparing the net for the next working day when Jesus came. In the midst of his failure, Jesus stepped into the boat and said, I want to make use of the boat. Now, even though things were hard for Peter, he willingly yielded his boat for the preaching of the gospel. And by the time Jesus was leaving, he, you know, compensated him with, net-breaking cash. A boat-sinking cash that he needed his friends to come and help him out. What is it that makes the difference? His willingness to say, well, if God demanded for this, I will be willing to give it out. And in giving it out, he got everything that needed to be gotten. Ephesians chapter 1, as we read from verse 17 to 18, it is very vital to get your understanding enlightened. He said, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that he may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Always remember that the word covenant is used in the Bible to refer to the relationship between God and his people. As a matter of fact, the Bible itself is a book of covenant. Old covenant, new covenant. So what is it that he covenanted between us? As we live our life to please him, as we live our life to serve him, as we live our life to reference him, everything that he promised become manifestation in our life. Please take note of one thing. Your service to God is not just your coming for service. Because a number of people miss out when they say they are not serving God. They say, I go to church. Now, going to church is not serving God. Going to church is just one part of it that connects you to service. Serving God requires a devotion with your life. Your life must be give a devotion unto God. Your service is beyond the wall, the four wall of the church, but it is also unto the wall. It must show a mark of righteousness to the wall. It must show the mark of goodness to the wall. You can't be serving God and be cruel to your fellow brothers and sisters. You can't be serving God and not in love with the people that Jesus died for. Your service to God requires that your life is consecrated unto God. Your life is consecrated unto God. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. What is it that the Bible calls your reasonable service? The presentation of your body unto God as a living sacrifice. For those who have seen the people in African tradition, when you go and consult an oracle and it demands that you bring a goat, as soon as that goat gets to the hand of the priest, it is no longer your own. Now, he determines what he wants to do with the goat. And most of the time, when they ask you to bring goat, they ask you to bring salt, bring palm oil, because those are the things that will go with it, and get some yam, so that when they cook the goat, they will use it for pounded yam. But what is done to the goat is none of your business. So when he killed the goat, he cut the head, cut the leg, and go and put it at the crossroad. The remaining one goes to his pot. So you don't have any business as to what he does with the goat. That goat becomes a sacrifice. If he cares, he may not even kill the thing and decided to put it at his backyard and let it continue to reproduce there. You can't go back and say you want to take that goat. You have given the goat. Now that is a living sacrifice. It's no longer your own. Now when you are a living sacrifice, your life is no longer your own. You live for God. That was the picture that Paul was painting for us in Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. When he said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Which means I am already dead. But I now have a life in me that is not my own. And so if the light that is in me is no longer my own, I can't afford to do what I want with the life that is in me. The life that I now live is from Christ, who gave himself, who died for me, and gave himself unto me. What is your reasonable service unto the Lord? It is to make yourself a living sacrifice unto the Lord. And as long and as much as you keep yourself unto him, you begin to see, you continue to see the manifestation, the performance, the fulfillment of everything that God has promised. It is my earnest prayer that the one who keep mercy to thousands of them that walk in his way will keep covenant for you in the mighty name of Jesus. He will show himself great and mighty over your life in the mighty name of Jesus. All after the flood, God made a covenant with Noah. Genesis chapter 9, verse 16. And the theologian calls that the Noah covenant. And that covenant says, no matter what happened, there will never be another flood. God will not use flood again to destroy the world. Now, because it is a promise he has made and nothing will change it. But for that promise to come, it was provoked by the man Noah. Amen? It was provoked. God, the promise never failed. And so we must keep ourselves. And we must continue to walk therein to see the manifestation of the grace and the power of the Most High. What is it that he said concerning your long life? Psalm 91 verse 16. He said, with long life will I satisfy you and show him my salvation. Hallelujah. With long life will I satisfy him and I will show him my salvation. He promised to protect. The same Psalm 91, as you read from verse 10 to 11, he said, there shall not evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come near thy dwelling. For he shall give his angel charge over thee to keep thee all thy way. As you go out and as you come in, may the awesome presence of the Lord be there to keep you away from all evil and away from all danger. In the mighty name of Jesus. And when you have the assurance that he will preserve you, you'll be able to say like David said in Psalm 118 verse number 17. Psalm 118 verse 17. I shall not die but live to declare the works of the Lord. If you know and you are sure that God is on your side, you will make a declaration of what they say. Covenant people of God, you need to emphasize this again and again and again and again, and God will manifest himself in your life in the name of Jesus. In Malachi chapter 4 in verse 2, he confirmed your healing when he says, but for you who feared my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with the healing in his wing, and you will go free, go forth as the calf in the stall. Hallelujah. That is the promise of the Lord. Whatever it is that wants to stand against that, definitely the power of God will nullify them. Anything that is aching and healing around your body, today, by the power of the Most High, they are eliminated. Amen. They are removed. Amen. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. It is written, Matthew chapter 8, verse 17, he said, he himself has taken our sickness and removed our diseases. So whatever things that wants to suggest sickness in your body, you must say it again and again, that God has promised and he will not fail. And Jeremiah chapter 30 verse 17, Jeremiah 30, 17, he said, for I will restore health unto thee, and I will heal thee of thy wounds, saith the Lord, because they call thee an outcast, saying, this is Zion, whom no man seeketh after. Not only heal, he said, he will restore health. This is the promise. And the God who never fails will always keep his word. I want to believe God with you this morning that the one who never fails will continue to manifest himself in your life in the name of Jesus. What is your own part? Serve the Lord. Consecrate your life. Let your life glorify God. As long as your life glorifies God, the blessing of God will be overwhelming in your life. So what should be your prayer today? Father, let my life please you. If only your life can please the Lord, every blessing of God will be found in your life. And I decree into your life this morning, everything that it takes for your life to please the Lord will grant unto you. And because your life will please the Lord, all the blessings of God that are in him, yea and amen, will begin to manifest over your life. In the mighty name of Jesus. Your life will show the goodness of God. The covenant-keeping God that never failed Abraham, that never failed Isaac, that never failed Jacob, that never fail all the fathers of faith will never fail you in the name of Jesus. What is that area of your life where you are expecting God's intervention? I stand to declare this morning that as the Lord live and as his spirit live, the Lord will arise for you. The Lord will come for you in the mighty name of Jesus. In every aspect of life, God will prove himself as the Most High in the name of Jesus. In blessing, he will bless you. In multiplying, he will multiply you. There will never again be any abortive effort in your life in the mighty name of Jesus. There will never be another fruitless effort in your life in the name of Jesus. May the Lord preserve you. May the Lord keep you in your going out and in your coming in. May he sustain you and may you enjoy good health and long life in the mighty name of Jesus. May nothing threaten your life. May you live your life in peace and in well-being in the mighty name of Jesus. Long life that coupled with prosperity, may it be your portion in the mighty name of Jesus. May the world see the mark of God's honor upon your life. And beginning from today, may the Lord create his fear over your life, that animals and the wicked will see you and they will tremble. Wherever you go, as the lion is feared in the jungle, may the Lord send his fear ahead of you in the mighty name of Jesus. May the grace of the Most High that keep a man standing for the Lord rest over your life in the mighty name of Jesus. May your life make all the difference. May your life show all the blessing. May the Lord be glorified upon your life in the mighty name of Jesus. If you believe it, let your amen be better.